Praise the Lord, everybody. Good morning, saints of the Most High God. Hallelujah. Good morning, citizens of the kingdom. Good morning to our Morning Manna Ministry Table. Yes, good morning, everybody. Let's boldly proclaim from the onset that this is the day that the Lord our God has made, and we are cognitively choosing to rejoice and to be glad in it. Magnify the Lord with me this morning. Let us exalt his name together. The Lord our God is good, and he is worthy to be praised. Amen. Help me honor him this morning. He's our Heavenly Father, y'all. He's our maker and our creator. Let me say it again. Help me magnify him, because he's our Heavenly Father, our maker and our creator. And we are praising him particularly on this holy week, because he has given unto us the expressed image of himself in his son, Christ Jesus, who dies on that cross, raised from the dead to sit on the right hand of the Father. And so we want to take a moment and acknowledge and appreciate the Lord Jesus Christ, Yeshua, the Christ, Son of the living God, for who he is to you and I. We never want to forget that. We're here because of him. We're grateful because of him. And that we are honoring him this morning for the precious gift of the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the living God. I need to remind you all that he lives and abides on the inside of every born again believer. And we're thankful to the Lord for the presence of the Holy Ghost in the lives of the people of God. And we're so grateful to have you all with us on today. Hallelujah. It's an exciting week for us. It is Passion Week. It is Holy Week. But it is also our time of celebration here at the table. Amen. We are celebrating our fifth year on the broadcast. And some of the saints are going to be with us to come and express their gratitude, their appreciation, and share hearts one with another. It's going to be a great day. If it's anything like on Monday, we're looking for the Lord to do great and mighty things in our lives. And so we're great and mighty things here at the broadcast as well. So I want to take a moment and tell everybody good morning again, and thank you so much for being here. Vicky, good morning to you. Sister Crystal Brooks, we're on it. We're on it. Amen. We're hoping to get all of the others on this Friday who have not been on Monday or Wednesday. But we're looking at you. The last chance you get now is on Friday. If you want to be on, if you want to jump on and just come and share testimony, if you want, or you can come and hang out and just take over like Diosha did on Monday, and just, you know, let everybody know how much you love and appreciate the table and how it's been a blessing to you. Amen. But we're grateful. Good morning, Brother Stefan. Good morning, Vicky. Thank God for you. Lady Betty Cole, good morning. Gloria and Rich Shaw, hallelujah. We got your family with us this morning. Hallelujah. We're going to be excited to have Sister Jackie with us. Amen. Elder Brockett is going to be back with us. Kathy is going to be here, y'all. You know you got to be ready for that on this morning. We've got a surprise for y'all. I'm going to let her tell you when she comes. But we are excited to have the woman of God with us on this morning. So praise the Lord. Sister Camilla, good morning to you. Thank God for you. Hallelujah. Sister Williams, good morning, dear. Amen. Evangelist McGee, good morning. Sister McLean Delos, y'all whole family, good morning to y'all. Hallelujah. Yes, ma'am. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Elder Brockett is coming momentarily and lead us in worship. And we are thankful. Diosha, man, we enjoyed you on Monday. May the Lord bless you, my brother. We're back safely in Georgia, y'all, back in our home setting, and thankful to the Lord how he's keeping us, and praising God for him for all that he does for us. Nicole, good morning to you, dear. Good morning. Good morning. Pastor Jackie, good morning to you. Bless you. Sister Nisi, good morning, dear. I mean, man, good morning. Deborah Levine, I hope I'm pronouncing it right. Levine, good morning to you, dear. Brenda, good morning to you as well. Sister Fran, hallelujah. Shalanda, good morning, dear. Thank God for you as well. Hallelujah. Each one of you that are coming in, Joanne, Brian, good morning to you. Camilla, hallelujah. Amen. All of the saints of the Most High God, all of you that make this table. Sister Angie, good morning, Terry. Good morning to you, dear. I appreciate you. Good morning, Sister Andrea Young. We thank God for you. Listen, if you are a first-time viewer of the broadcast, we always have to take a moment and appreciate you. You could be anywhere early this morning, could be still under your covers, but you're here. Amen. Or you're on your job listening, you're in route, wherever you may be, sharing the broadcast on this morning. We just want to say appreciate you. Yeah, did we enjoy him? He was such a blast. I might try to sneak him in today because Kathy is here, and him and Kathy, you know, they got their own little thing going on. But we're grateful to the Lord, because a very heart does do us good, like a medicine. Amen. So listen, I want to take a moment before we get Elder Brockington and our rest of our panel on this morning and share a devotional thought with you and pray. And then we're going to enjoy each other on this morning. I got a call on yesterday evening from one of my young daughters in the faith. And she her heart had been shattered and broken. And she's calling me up, and she's in pain. And because she's in pain, it makes me in pain because of the way that I feel for her. I don't like her seeing her hurt. I don't like knowing that she's going through what it is that she's going through. And what she's going through is not the issue. It's her. It's the fact that she is going through it, because all of us, when we go through what we go through, it impacts our lives. And if we're not prepared for the moment, it not only does it impact our lives to the extent that it hurts us, but it changes us. I want you to bear with me for just a moment, because if I'm not prepared for what hits me, not only does it impact me by virtue of the pain, but it changes me. And a lot of times, unbeknownst to me, it changes me. It changes the way I interact with other people. It changes me as it pertains to my ministry. It changes my mental capacity. It changes the way words come out of my mouth. When we are not prepared to deal with life and what life brings, if we're not careful, it changes us. It just doesn't hurt us, but it changes. You'd be shocked at the number of people who never get through, never get over what they got hit with. It absolutely changed their lives for the rest of their lives. So every relationship that they have is a result of what hit them that they never properly processed through. You'd be shocked at the number of people who what they went through is expressed, particularly in the church, is expressed in their ministry. You'd be shocked at the number of pastors who preach the way they preach because of what they've been through. And I don't believe it's the will of God for outside sources or situations that hit us to change us, particularly for the negative. But if we're not careful, these situations that hit us, and they come at us, and a lot of times they catch us by surprise, and we struggle with how we deal with them. She calls me up, and this thing is wearing her out. And she calls me, obviously, most times when people call a servant of God, they're looking for prayer. But I'm realizing that I need the Holy Spirit to give us more than just a moment of prayer. That has to be a moment of wisdom in this situation. And I want to share with you all this passage of scripture that obviously you've heard before, but I want you to really digest it perhaps from a different perspective on this morning. It's from the Christian Standard Version of the Bible, that version, where the Apostle Paul writes to the church. Now listen carefully again to what he says to the church at Philippi. In the King James Version, it's "be anxious for nothing." In the CSB, it's "don't worry about anything." Listen to what he's saying. Obviously, that's a challenge for a lot of us, not to worry about something that hit us hard, that challenged us. But he says to the church at Philippi, you have got to graduate to a place, get to a place, elevate your faith to a place where you are not moved by, changed by anything. Don't tell me it can't be done, or he would not be admonishing us to do it. And this is part of the purpose and the power of the Holy Spirit in the life of a believer. Others can change, but you, as a born-again believer, you, as a word carrier, you as the instrument that God wants to use to impact your family, impact people on your job. You can't afford to let life change you for the negative, to the extent that what's coming out of you now is not a result of the Spirit of God that's in you. What's coming out of you is anger. What's coming out of you is frustration. What's coming out of you is pain. And that is not who you really are. And so Paul says, don't worry. Don't be over anxious. Don't be overwhelmed. Don't let anything get to you like that. But in everything, through prayer, he's talking to a specific group of people. He can't be talking to unsaved people. He can't be talking to worldly people because they're not people of prayer. He says, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving. Did you catch it? Through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests, your petitions unto God. And something will happen when you follow the format, when you follow the blueprint. Something is bound to happen. What will happen, Bishop? It's the peace of God that will overwhelm you. It will surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. So let's make it real easy and simple as it pertains to what the apostle is saying here this morning. He's literally telling us, first thing you need to do is prepare yourself. And part of the preparation is to understand you will get hit. If pain is coming, problems are coming. You're not exempt from them. Pain is coming. Problems are coming. Situations are coming. And if you're not prepared for them, they will wear you out. If you don't have if you're not like a first responder, you got to be prepared for when the situation happens. You got to know that it could be around the corner at any minute. It could be a situation occurring at any minute. You got to get beyond this. It caught me off guard. You got to get beyond this. I wasn't prepared for it. And there is a way that you are consistently prepared for it. You don't need to know exactly what it is, but this is part of the purpose and the power of the Holy Spirit. This is part of the purpose and the power of the Word of God, so that you are so filled with the Word, you are so filled with the Spirit, that when a situation does occur, you have a rapid response. You have a rapid response. You're not running around here anxious. You're not overrunning around here. Oh my God, what am I going to do? You know what you're going to do, because he is in you. And he that is in you is greater than he that is not in you. Greater is he that is in you. And so you got to be prepared, Morning Manna. You got to get beyond getting prepared. You got to, what the senior saints used to say, you have to be prayed up. You got to get to the place where you're not praying, but you got to be in a position where I'm prepared to deal with whatever. Are y'all with me? And see, this is part of a prayer life. This is part of reading the Word of God. This is a part of all that you do in this spiritual realm. You have to be prepared for the spirituality of what you're going through, not just the natural moment. My young daughter is crying because of the natural pain that she's going through, but she fails to understand that there is a greater spiritual thing behind this. Yeah. Thank you, Pastor Burr, Pastor Ron. That you got to hide that word in your heart so that when the negativity comes, it does not cause you to sin against him. Thank you, sir. You got to hide that word. So prepare yourself. And when you prepared yourself, Paul says, through prayer and supplication. So after I have ensured that I've hidden the word in my heart, after I have prepared myself by walking in the Spirit, and this is why you can't be up and down with God. You can't be in and out with God. You got to have a consistent life with God. I'm not suggesting that. I'm not talking about being deep spiritual, walking around with your head in the sky all the time. I'm just talking about being spiritual. I'm just talking about, this is who I am. You're born again. You're a child of the Most High God. I'm not suggesting that you don't enjoy life. I enjoy life, but I'm always talking to God. I'm always walking with God. I'm always consulting God. No matter where you are, no matter what you're doing, don't tell me you can't have him in your spirit. You're always walking with God. You're always talking with God. You are a born again child of God. And so praying doesn't mean get in your closet and pray sincerely. I mean, having a praying spirit on your way to work, wherever you are, you're always praying, Lord, I thank you. You're always conversing with God, even in the midst of whatever it is you're going through. So you're going to have to prepare yourself. And you're going to have to let your prayer petition be made known. No matter when you get hit, immediately when you get hit, you got to have a response. You got to have a response immediately, because if you don't, the enemy will send something that will knock you down, tear you down, break you down, because you were not prepared with the proper response. Prayer, let your petition be made known unto God. It's the prayer. And then he said, with thanksgiving, which means in the midst of it all. This is a one-time shot, y'all. All this should be happening. All of this should be happening at the same time, that I'm prepared for whatever comes at me. Immediately, my petition is be made known unto God. God, you see my situation, no matter what it is that I'm going through. I'm going to take a moment and praise you. Thank you that my needs are already met. In the midst of what I heard from the doctor, I know what the doctor said, and it sounds negative to my ear, but God, I was prepared for it. I was prepared for it. It shocked me. It hit me. I gave it a little 30 seconds or whatever, but immediately I began to, no weapon formed against me is going to prosper. It's not being deep. It's being spiritually responsive. Spiritually responsive. How do you respond when you get hit? You got to have a plan. Here is the plan. You got to prepare yourself. You got to pray. Let your petition be made known unto God. You got to do it with thanksgiving. There ought to be a praise for every problem. Good God Almighty. There ought to be a praise for every problem. There ought to be a praise for every moment of pain. Every moment of pain. If you don't have something to fight back with, my mother used to tell my tale, get back out there and get in the fight. Don't what you're running up in here for. Get back out there and get in the fight. You got to have a response immediately for what you're going through. If you don't, that thing will wear you out. It will wear you down. You got to have the knowledge to prepare myself, because it could be coming at any moment. It could be coming around the corner. So I'm going to stay, as the senior saint said, prayed up. I'm going to always be praying. I'm going to let my petition be made known unto God, and I'm going to do it with thanksgiving. He said, then he says, listen, when you do it with thanksgiving, present it to God. He says, listen, through prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests unto God. Did you hear what he said? Present yourself. Give me a moment here. Present your requests unto God. How you present your request unto God is extremely important. If you're going to God as David, you remember David? Yeah, Amalekites. Yeah, they came in, destroyed. How he presented his request unto God was extremely important. He that cometh unto God must believe that he is. You can't come to God with all this boo-hoo crying and, Lord, are you going to come? You got to come with the right attitude. You got to come in faith. You got to come with praise. You got to know how to present yourself unto him. And when you present yourself in the proper way, amen. It's how your children, when they come to you and want something from you, if they come with the right attitude, you probably have no problem with giving it to your children. You probably have no problem, depending on the situation, obviously, but how they present themselves. Mama, I have a situation going on. Dad, I got how you present yourself. If you're overwhelmed by the problem, overwhelmed by the situation, and I understand that tears may be flowing, but let not your tears be tears of doubt. Not let your tears be tears of wondering whether or not he's going to hear you when he cries. Let your tears be tears of joy. Father, I'm hurting, but I know you got it. Father, I'm going through, but I know you got it. I'm going to give you praise for it. I'm not going to wait till I come out. I'm going to praise you while I'm in it. That's a whole different attitude. That's a whole different attitude than somebody that's praying and asking God to deliver them, and they're not sure in their mind whether or not he can. So I want to make sure you got it this morning as we take this moment for you to understand how your response should be when you get hit. You got to have a plan already. So how about from the jump, you be prepared by prayer being a part of your life consistently. I'm not talking about the prayer that you have when you're in the closet. There's a time for that. I'm just talking you walking in the spirit. I'm talking about you always prepared for that which is inevitable, because it's coming. Prepare yourself so that your prayer and your petition is an immediate response. You're not cursing back. You're not upset. Prayer and petition is my immediate response, along with thanksgiving or praise unto God. That of all people, Father, Job says, naked I came, you know, I came into this world naked. I shall have the Lord God give it. The Lord God take it away. But blessed, there's that praise, but blessed be the name of the Lord. And then present whatever that petition is. Yeah, present yourself also before God in a manner in which is pleasing. And then finally, he said to them, and the peace of God, which surpasseth all understanding. Did y'all read that? And the peace of God. It's not your peace. It's his peace that he gives to you supernaturally to deal with whatever it is. It's a spiritual peace. It's not a natural peace. It's not peace because you have money. It's not peace because you have friends. It's not that peace. It's the peace that surpasseth all understanding. Some of you never have it because you didn't put the plan in action. The peace that surpasseth all natural understanding will guard your heart. Once you present yourself, beloved, then protect your peace. I want to tell my daughter, listen, you can't go out unprotected. The world will wear you out. The people in the world, men, women, they'll wear you out. It's not just humanity that you all are dealing with. I'm going to say this and we're done. We keep making the mistake, Pastor Jackie, of viewing everything through the human lens. We keep making the mistake of viewing everything through the human lens. And you keep talking about what he did, what she did, what they did. They were just the vessel through which the situation came. When are you going to go deeper in your thought pattern and realizing that what's happening to me, while it did come through an individual and they should be held accountable for allowing the enemy to use them, but when are you going to go deeper and realize what I need to go after is the spirit that this person is operating in? Because if you only see it through the natural human lens, it will stop right there and you will only deal with the person. And the person needs deliverance. When are you going to pray about their deliverance? When are you going to see that what they caused came from a deeper source than just them? Of course they need to be held accountable. Of course they should have known better, just like you and I should have known better when we did what we did. But at the end of the day, there's a peace that will come over you. Because right now, when she gets off the phone, she says, thank you, Bishop, for calming me down. It wasn't me who calmed her down. The peace of God came into the telephone conversation. And now she's better because the peace of God, which came through the knowledge of the word of God. Y'all, this peace. Yeah. And when you understand it, you understand what God is attempting to try to do in our lives. Oh, it's good to see you, man. It's good to see you. It's good to have you with us. And so I'm hoping this morning that each one of us will understand how valuably important your peace is, the peace that comes from the Father. I'm saying this and we're getting ready to pray. You cannot afford to be void of peace. You cannot afford to be void of the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. I want you to imagine for a moment what happens to you when your peace is gone. What kind of person do you turn in when you have no peace? When there is the absence of peace, you are a wreck. You know you are a wreck. And some of you can look back over your life and you remember the kind of person you became when you got hit because you had no peace. The peace of God that surpasses understanding that Paul says will keep your heart. It will guard your heart and your mind. The only reason some of you are stable today is because you have the Spirit of God in you, and the peace of God kept you from going off. The peace of God kept you from saying some things and doing some things that you know would have been detrimental to your walk with God. And thereby, we give God praise for it on this morning. We we give him, yeah, glory for it on this morning. This is why we honor him. This is why we need the Spirit of the living God. Yeah, this is why we need the Holy Ghost. This is why, yeah, it's a peace that storm, in the midst of the storm, his peace is able to just overwhelm. Yes, I'll mess without the peace of God. Hallelujah. We're getting ready to pray on this morning. So we want everybody, let your requests be made known unto God. No matter what it is, you're a child of the Most High God. And that doesn't mean you're arrogant. That doesn't mean that you are caught up in narcissism. It means that you know who you are in God and you have access to the peace of God. And because you have access to the peace of God, it overwhelms any negativity that's going on in your life. And so no matter what it is on this morning, let it be made known unto God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's spend a few moments here in the presence of God. Let's put up a few moments thanking the Lord for who he is. Father, we bless you on this morning. We honor you on this morning. We exalt you on this morning. We extol you on this morning. We recognize that you alone are God. You alone are Yahweh, who is the Elohim. You alone are worthy of glory, honor, and praise. So, Father, this morning we take a moment to tell you thank you. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for this loving kindness and these tender mercies, Father, that continue to overwhelm us, that continue to sustain us and keep us. We thank you this morning, Father, that in you we live, we move, and we have our being. We exist solely because you've permitted it. And so this morning we want to tell you thank you, Lord. Thank you for the blessings of the Lord that maketh rich and you add no sorrow to it. Thank you this morning, Father, that you are the Lord God Almighty. Hallelujah. Our healer, our deliverer, our maker. And so, Father, I gather together with your people on this morning, and we're letting our petitions be made known. Before that, Father, we've prepared ourselves in the Spirit, Lord. We've prepared ourselves, oh God, to give you praise, glory, and honor, to thank you. No matter what comes against us, we refuse to be overwhelmed by it. We refuse to worry about it until it causes us, Lord, to be unstable. But we present it to you, Father, and we tell you thank you that you hear our hearts when we cry, Lord. In the midst of all that we have to go through in our humanity, we yet give you thanks, Father, because we realize that he that cometh unto God must believe that he is, and you are a rewarder of those that diligently seek you. So we lean not to our own understanding. We lean to the word of God. We lean to the Spirit of God. We lean on you on this morning, Father, and we say, have your way. Now, praying with my brothers and my sisters on this morning, Father, that you would continue, hallelujah, to pour out of your Spirit upon them. It is because of your Spirit, Father, that we are strengthened so that we might be able to endure hardness as good soldiers. I'm in agreement with my brothers and my sisters this morning, Father, who need a move of God. A miraculous move of God to occur in their lives. Negative news has been heard from the doctors. Negative news has been spoken into their ear. But Father, there is a peace that surpasses all understanding that will keep our hearts and keep our minds and keep us from being overwhelmed by circumstances and situations. I pray for your peace on this morning to land into the hearts of many at this table who came to this table, Father, overwhelmed by circumstances and situations. But you are sending a word to them on this morning. You're sending a word to them on this morning to encourage them and to remind them that you are God. You have the final say so. You are the healer. You are the deliverer. You are the way maker. And so regardless to what we see with our eyes, hear with our ears, we tell you thank you on this morning. And so Father, as you bless this table, as you breathe on this table, as you use the people of God at this morning to be an encouragement to this table, we tell you thank you in advance. We tell you thank you in advance. We know that victory belongs to the children of God. Victory belongs to the Most High God. You caused us to triumph in Christ Jesus. You always cause us to triumph. And so, Lord, we tell you thank you. We give you praise on this morning. We give you glory on this morning. We give your name the highest praise on this morning. Our souls say, yes, Lord, yes to your will, yes to your way. No matter what it is that we're going through, there is a yes that resonates in the hearts and the minds of the people. And so we tell you, thank you for it on this morning, Lord. Thank you that you hear your people when they cry. And so, God, we give you praise on this morning. We tell you thank you on this morning. And we thank you in the midst of whatever it is that we're going through. We praise you in the midst of whatever it is that we're going through. And with every heart that is at this table, Lord, we've learned how to say thank you. We've learned how to say thank you. We've learned how to say thank you on this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. This is the heart cry of your servants this morning. The heart cry of your servants this morning. And we give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, Lord, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody, tell him amen on this morning. Hallelujah. No matter what it is. And I mean that with all sincerity. No matter what it is, tell him thank you on this morning. Tell him thank you on this morning. Not because I asked you to tell him thank you, because the word of God teaches us there must be a praise. He that cometh to God must believe that he is, and he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. How you present yourself to him matters. Yeah, you may be lay aside that weight and the sin that does so easily beset you, lay that aside and present yourself unto him in a manner which says you recognize who he is. When you come into the doctor's office, you know who the doctor is. You present yourself. You start telling him all of your symptoms. You start telling him all of your situation with the expectation that he has a proper response for you, that the prescription that he is going to provide for you is one that's going to help you. You go into the doctor's office with that level of faith. Why don't you go in your prayer closet with that level of faith? You go into the lawyer's office. You lay out your case before him in hopes that he's going to be able to defend you. Jesus is your, He's more than just your defense attorney. Hallelujah. He's your all in all. Hallelujah. Lord bless you on this morning. Hallelujah. The Lord bless you on this morning. It's already all right, baby girl. It's already all right. We're going to thank him in the midst of it. We're going to thank him because of it. Hallelujah. Some of y'all, you got too many people. Thank you, Lord. Some of you have too many people. I hear it in the Holy Ghost. Some of you have too many people in your corner who can get a prayer through. You forgot about them. You forgot about the people. This ain't even about you, because some of you, where you are, it's heavy on you. I get it. I understand. It's heavy on you. But what happens when you get blessed and you couldn't get a prayer through? You couldn't get it through because it was overwhelming you. But you forgot. You had some family members. You had some church folks. You had some people who you know love you, who are connected to you. You got through because their prayer got through. You got through what you were going through because their prayer got through. You ought to give God praise for it on this morning. Hallelujah. Let's get ready, y'all. So much we have at this table this morning to get to, and I want you to be prepared for it. So let's prepare our hearts. The prophet is going to come bless us in worship. We're going to hit this table with some people that I know are going to bless your heart with the thoughts that they have that God has given unto them, and we're going to enjoy the Lord on this morning. Hallelujah. Jesus, praise the Lord, everybody. Good morning, Elder Brockington.
Good morning, Bishop. Good morning, Morning Manna family. As always, it's a blessing to be here, being the number one.
Amen. It's a blessing to have you here with us. Kathy is with us on this morning. Good morning, Kathy.
Hey, Auntie. Sister.
Look at her. Yeah, that Starkeisha is with us this morning. Good morning.
Hey, Good morning.
Oh Lord, we got people with us this morning who gonna keep Kathy in check. Everybody's here to keep Kathy in check on this morning. We're looking for the Lord to bless us. Listen, we're going to release Elder Brockett to let her bless us on this morning. I brought you all in a little bit early because I want y'all to enjoy the worship encounter with us as well. And so here are the people in your corner this morning, Elder Brockett.
Yes, they are.
And to God for you being with us. And so I'm going to let y'all do y'all intros a little bit later after she blesses us, and then we'll go from there. Amen. So we're in your hand, Elder Brockett. Bless you, dear.
Amen. Amen. We are in celebration of Resurrection Week and of Holy Week. And I just wanted to share a song from that. I know that he is alive. He has risen. Amen.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. He is alive. Bless your holy name.
Amen.
Not dead.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Now I understand why they call for the encore. Like, you got to take that a little further and add some more to that. Hallelujah.
Add some more to that.
We was in church, we'd all be all over the floor. Now we'd be all over the place. Ooh, Lord.
Jesus. Yes, Lord. Lord.
Don't cry. Wipe
Don't cry.
Your eyes. He's not dead. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Elder Brockington, thank you so much, first of all. When you sing that song, and I know it's commemorative with the season that we are in, but the reality of those words, what's the message for you? What's the message for you? What's the message, Kathy? What's the message, Starkeisha, that we should be getting from the lyrics of that song? Elder Brockington, your thoughts.
Just letting us know that it doesn't matter what we go through. You know, he paid it all.
Yeah.
He paid it all, as the word said, on that lonely highway, everything that we go through. I did one of our Tuesday, spiritual Tuesday that we do with ECC. And God had showed to me, he says, it's part of the plot, the plan, and the purpose. Mm. Everything that we go through is all part of the plot, the plan, and the purpose. And so because he's already fixed it, it's already been planned out. Dry your weeping eyes. And know that our God, although they crucified him, he's yet alive. Yeah. He's still living and he is still working on our behalf. So don't cry. Dry your weeping eyes.
Yes.
God got us. Yes. So enjoy the peace of God.
Amen. Hallelujah. We're going to let you go because you were here on Monday.
Amen.
But we're going to let you go and talk about you behind your back.
Okay.
But you're still heroes. But it'll all be good.
Good talk. Amen. I need good talk.
What Diosha said on Monday just still rings in our ear. How he, I can see it when he said he took his device into the office.
Mm.
You were singing and set the office aflame. And so we'll talk behind your back, but know that it's all good.
Oh, this Amen. Week. Amen. Amen. Love y'all.
We love you. Oh, Lord have mercy. And so we're so grateful. Kathy, since the table really knows you, they may not know Starkeisha like they know you. We're going to let Starkeisha jump in here. First of all, take a moment, introduce yourself to us. And then don't forget that song that Elder Brockington, we need to talk about her. The way she be singing is ridiculous. And the way the Lord be using her is just ridiculous. The table, we should be paying for some of that stuff that we get. But good morning, dear. Thank you so much, first of all, for accepting the invitation to come and be with us. But take a moment and address the table on this morning.
Good morning. You're welcome. Good morning, table. So for all who doesn't know me, I am Starkeisha, the daughter of Gloria and Rich. So if you guys see Gloria and Rich, y'all, I'm their daughter. I have my aunts are on here. I have Camellia is my aunt. That's my oldest aunt. And then you have Jacqueline Akirley. So table full of family. But I was brought to the table from my mom. However, we was brought to the table from my Aunt Mia, well, Camellia. So I believe Camellia is a member of your church, Bishop.
Mm-hmm.
And I was going through something. I don't know during that time what I was going through, but my mom kept saying, you need to just listen to Bishop Benton. And I was like, Ma, I don't want to. So she was trying to make me listen to you. And I was like, no, because, you know, it's online. And I didn't want to believe listening to a bishop online. So I listened to you one day and I was like, this bishop know what he's talking about a little bit. Kind of feel it. And I want to say Elder Brockington was singing. And I didn't realize that I met Elder Brockington a long time ago.
Wow.
But she was singing. And I think I had lost my job during this time. And I was in the shower. So a lot of times I'm doing stuff when I'm listening to the broadcast. And I was in the shower and she was singing a song about you're enough, you're worthy. Why aren't you worthy enough?
Yeah.
That brought me to the table, literally, is what brought me to the table because I kept feeling like I wasn't worthy enough for a lot of stuff. And then the song. So let's address this song this morning. Because that helps a lot. It made me feel like it hit me because I do cry a lot. And I feel like sometimes God isn't moving or he doesn't hear me. And I'm like, why isn't he moving fast enough? But he's not dead. He does hear me. He's just moving on his time. So that song just kind of hit me like, stop crying, dry your eyes. He's working. He's coming. So it just made me think that when I feel like he's not moving, just give him some time. It took him 3 days to rise. So maybe on that third day, my blessing's coming. It may not be a technical third day. It might be a third year or a month or whatever, but it's coming. So that song hit me.
Amen. It hit. I think it hit all of us. Yeah. You know, as I'm so grateful to your mom and bringing you to the table, all of your family. Those genes run real deep in y'all family. Lord have mercy. I don't know who. I'm like, what? Wait a minute. That's Jack. No, that's okay. And so
you should see my kids.
Lord, I saw your brother. I think it's his birthday today.
Yes, it's his brother today. His birthday today.
Yeah, so we're extending birthday greetings to your brother. I think it's Kenneth. Is that him?
Yep, that's Kenneth.
Keep my mind. It's working still good. It's still working good. Amen. But you know, what God is doing and has done behind the scenes has been amazing to me. I'm gonna say to you, Kathy, we coming. We can be careful. We coming. But I want to say to you, there was a broadcast that we were doing about our parents and fathers and the role that they had in our lives. I think it may have been a minute ago, but you came on during that broadcast and shared some deep stuff, very personal stuff and transparent stuff that you had been through. And I never forgot that broadcast. I don't think you even know today the impact that you left me with, just because you were transparent enough to share your moment, your pain with the table. And you've been a part of the table since then. And so whether it's your comments or your personal coming on and sharing with us, I know if it blessed me, it had to bless. And some of you all who are on here now, you probably remember that broadcast because it was an impactful broadcast for many of us. But what you shared was such a blessing to me, and I had to say that to you personally, even now, that's a part of what joy we experience here at the broadcast. But for you personally, even after your mother has invited you and you came, is there a memorable moment for you that you've derived from the table?
Yes, because that's what made me change my Facebook name to Starkeisha. I can't remember the exact. It was sometime this year. This year just started. So it was late last year. And you were saying to stop dimming your light and stop appeasing everybody. You need to please God. And I was like, you know what? I do live my life to make everything easier for everyone else. And I was tired of it. And that day literally felt like a ton came off of me. So I went on there and I was like, you know what? I'm tired of being called Star just because people can't say Starkeisha, and it's really simple to say, but because people get uncomfortable and I see their face changes and I see their body language change, I will immediately say, you can just say Star to make them comfortable. Even though now I'm sad because you've skipped trying to say my name. You're not acknowledging me. Yes, we are crybabies, Ayosha, but hit me. And so it used to make me angry until that day you said, stop appeasing God and live for God, live for you. So I said, you know what? I have to do that. I have to start doing what I want to do and stop being quiet because people always say I talk too much. So Diosha, we both have a mouth. I love you. I have a lot of stories. So, you know, people be, you're talking too much because you're telling too much. Well, no, I'm just telling the truth and you don't want me to tell it. I'm going to tell it anyway. I'm sorry if you didn't want it to come out. So it was that broadcast that changed me really deeply because it made me start looking into myself and realize, hey, you don't do anything you want to do. You do everything else for everybody else.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a tremendous truth. And so we're really grateful. Can you hang with us for a minute?
I can hang with y'all.
Amen. Thank you. Amen. We appreciate that. Kathy Yarber is at the table, y'all. Hallelujah. She came for her revenge on this morning. I don't think Diosha wants you to talk on this morning, but you are here. First of all, thank you so much again for being here with us. You've been such a blessing, and so many of the saints here at the table have been tremendously blessed by your just who you are, whether it's the ministry gift or just who you are as a whole. So I'm hoping, as we said to Elder Brockington and to Diosha on Monday, that you all understand the impact that you have in people's lives. So first, come on, introduce, because we may have some people in here who have no idea who Kathy is. And so we need you to let us know and break it out the bubble.
I'm Kathy, and I was introduced at the table by Minister Angie Taylor. And I first listened, and I'm like, you know, this is a place where you could be real, where you can get meat from the word. It's okay sometimes if you have to do a drive-through at McDonald's, but sometimes you got to be able to sit down at a Chris Ruth and have you a good steak. And the word that comes from this table, and the word that I had heard in the beginning, I knew that I was having a meal, and it wasn't a snack. And it, in some way, it was always applicable to an area in my life, whether it was for encouragement or growth or insight or influence. It was always effective. And so I like to hang around ministries where I'm always fed. As Bishop and myself and Elder Brockington was talking about my books earlier, I love to be fed a good meal, you know, a nutritious meal. Yeah. You get a nutritious meal,
yeah,
table. You know, it's not a frozen pot pie or a TV dinner.
Amen.
It's a good, healthy meal. And so that's what I appreciate about being at the table. And I just want to let all of you know that I honor and thank Bishop for trusting my relationship with the Lord to be here with you. You know, I really don't take that lightly, because I know very conscious of who he will have before you. And he knows that he has to answer to God for what comes through this ministry. And so I don't take this lightly that he's asked me to be at the table to be part of the serving meal crew. And I so appreciate that, Bishop. Yeah. I appreciate this place. It's been a place of refuge for some people, a place where they have been rescued. I know they've been encouraged and taught. This Morning Manna has laid out a full course meal for people. And so when you come and sit, you could have already had your main dish and this is your dessert. Or you could have just come off of a fast and this is your first meal after your fast. Or you could have been in the desert roaming and wow, then you got to the table, it was your meal, your first meal. So I appreciate you all. I appreciate the encouragement from you, the laughs, the cries. I appreciate you. And so now, Bishop, I wanna say what I have to say about the song that Elder Brockington.
Amen.
When Jesus rose from the dead, the word tells us he rose with all power and authority.
Yeah.
But when he rose, He transferred that to us through him. And so when he rose, I think victory. I think victory over every situation. I think victorious. Okay. Because he did that, we can. Because he rose, I don't have to cry about a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
You know, dry your eyes. See, I don't have to cry. It's not that I see the answer or have the answer now. I don't have to cry because I know he can. Because he can. Sometimes that's all you have to hold on to in your circumstances or situations. The encouragement in knowing that he can, oh, I'm good. And my sister who's struggling, he already has the answer for what you're going through. Just like when we're in school and the teacher gives us a test and we fail a certain part, what do the teacher tell us? They tell us to go study that part that you fail in. So the teacher doesn't beat you and kick you out of class and say you could never come back. God is not rejecting you. He's saying, go back and study me in this area. So the next time you take the test, you'll already know how to handle it.
Mm-hmm.
Already know the answers. I'm a topical student of the word. When I have fears and stuff, I just eat all the scriptures about fear. When I am not feeling well, I eat all the scriptures about healing, because I want that scripture to be able to be regurgitated when, not if, when that situation comes around again. We're in this world, but we're not of the world.
Yeah.
Your tests and trials are going to come again. And so we have to be ready. I know sometimes, and this is it, Bishop, I don't mean to take over, but I want to encourage somebody's heart today. I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you. It's like your answer is always in the word. When I don't know what to say, I have a favorite song that I sing. I was speaking to a friend of mine from Kenya yesterday, and sometimes she's on here. I said, sing you a worship song. It has nothing to do with your feelings. Glorify God anyway. Praise God anyway. And then your flesh will come in line with your spirit and change the atmosphere. That doesn't mean you're going to have the answer yet, but at least your atmosphere is changed.
Hallelujah. Yeah. Yeah. It's the challenge, I think, for all of us. And it's just Sister Jackie, too, if you're available and ready, we want to bring you in as well. That last, when Elder Brockington is singing that song, Starkeisha, and I try to be a better listener than I am as a speaker. I try to be a better listener so that I can hear and respond, not with my own personal perspective or view, if you would, which sometimes can be helpful. But sometimes I think we need to realize that the Holy Spirit does work through us. And so your response a lot of times might not be your response. It may be what he gave you, unbeknownst to you, but you're sharing. And this is why we got to be quick to hear. We can't be so readily just want to say something out of a reaction. But that the Spirit of God would actually, you got to believe that, first of all, that, okay, God, if I be quiet and I say, Lord, give me something to say to Starkeisha, that he would actually do that. If you don't believe that, then why are you even praying that? But that he would actually speak through us. And so when she sings the song, Don't Cry, it's like a plea for understanding. Wipe those tears from your eyes, because you're crying for nothing. He's not dead. You think he's dead because you don't presently see him. But the reality is he's alive. And because he is alive, here is why you should not cry. You're going to go through some things, but this is what Paul means when he says, it's the peace of God. If we believe what Elder Brockington's song, if you really believe that, then peace of God comes over you. It surpasses understanding and it protects your heart and your mind because you know without a shadow of a doubt that you serve the living God, you serve the risen Savior, and because he has been raised from the dead, victory ultimately belongs to every believer. That doesn't mean you're not going to go through. It doesn't mean that you're not going to be challenged. What it does mean is it ought to change your mentality and the way you approach it. And so we're grateful to God. Kathy, thank you so much. We've got Sister Jackie with us on this morning as well.
Hey, Auntie.
Yeah, Lord, yeah. Look at him.
The Jesus. I think she's secretly my mom.
Without a doubt. So first, Sister Jackie, welcome. We appreciate you. I'm going to need you to take a moment and introduce yourself to us, if you don't mind, because there's some people at the table, they have saw your name appear on the screen on many occasions, and I need you to so that we can pronounce your name correctly, first of all, and we will know exactly who Sister Jackie is. Welcome to the table, dear.
Thank you. Thank you, Bishop. Elder Kathy Yarborough, good morning. My niece, Starkeisha, as well as all of Morning Manna Table. I'm Jackie. Akirley is the way to pronounce the last name. But anyway, I've been with Morning Manna since Tamika Brockington. She was the one that shared the information, and she knows me very well, very well, to the point where she really should be a sister. But anyway, we actually worked together for almost 4 years, and of course the bond was put there. So long story short, she introduced me to the table. I came on, and I'm always wanting to hear more. So I'm glad she did, because it's been such an inspiration for me. It's helped me understand so much more about the Bible, about my walk, about what I should and shouldn't be doing, even though you know these things, but it just puts even more clarity there. So, but that's who I am. Just little old me.
Little old you. Well, I am so glad that little old you has shared with us on this morning. Do you have a memorable moment, a memorable broadcast that impacted your life and either caused you to say, you know what, I'm staying here, or either, you know, something that just inspired you? Some we don't, because all of them are great, but there are some, again, for me, I go back to Stakisha and what she shared with us during that moment. That was one of those unforgettable moments for me. But is there a moment for you where Morning Manna just kind of touched your heart, helped you in that moment you were in?
Bishop, every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. It's not just one. I don't, trust me when I say it's literally every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. I can't really sit and pinpoint one from the past, I won't lie. But truly, like I say, it's a every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday growth. So I take bit by bit, whether it's a segment from this one and a segment from that one, I'm making my own Morning Manna per se in my head, if you will.
Amen.
So to elaborate on one specific one, truly it's hard to say.
I understand. Yes, sir. And maybe it shouldn't be a favorite one, but just one that kind of, you know, rings in your mind. But I get it. I think for me too, just being at the table and being able to share. And a lot of times I encourage you all to share your comments, because you don't know how your comments encourage me, encourage those that are at the table that are sharing as well. So, and while we're here, I did want to remind everybody we're in Holy Week. We're in this week of passion that Jesus is approaching his time of death, burial, and resurrection. And so on Sunday began Holy Week, and we talked a little bit about this. but I want to hear from you all on this morning as well. That whole triumphal entry, Kathy, and we're going to start with you, Kathy, and then we'll come around Sarkisha as well, and then Jackie. That whole triumphal entry, what's notable for me is that untying of the coat. That untying of the coat signified to me that Jesus had need of that coat, and how he has need. A lot of folks say that the Lord don't need you. I beg to differ. How is the word going to get out to the nations if the church isn't the instrument by which he uses to get it out to? And so there is a need that the Lord has for us, but many of us are yet tied to some things or some people or some situations, whether it's past, present, problems, pain, whatever it might be. We're tied to that, and it keeps us from being able to be used by God to carry the word, carry Jesus. So the Lord has to send maybe the table or send someone to loose us from what had us tied so that we could then be used by him. And so, Kathy, your thoughts on the triumphal entry, how it was utilized as a moment where Jesus says, I've got to liberate you and send word carriers, disciples into the city to untie that coat so that he could be used by Jesus. Your thoughts on whether it was the table, a moment at the table, whether how important it was just so that we could be untied.
One thing I see, Bishop, what I realize is that the untying and the utilizing was like instantaneous. You know, the donkey wasn't untied to be left there. God doesn't free us to remain where we are. The freeing, the setting free is only part of the transition, the transformation, the moving away from where you are to where he wants you to go. When God frees you, he already has a goal for you.
Yeah, that's good.
When God frees you, there's already a goal in place. And so your life circumstances and situations is that journey to get there. I'm sure that donkey stepped on some rocks and maybe clipped his foot on a tree, whatever. But guess what? Jesus said, I have need of you. I know the road is bumpy. I know it's probably some broken glass on the road that you're going to step in. But see, I need you, and I need you to keep moving.
Yeah.
I need you to keep going towards the goal. So that part of being free, man, that was a liberation. That's a liberation period where God releases you to go anywhere, but you've got to leave from where you are.
Yeah, yeah. And Sarkisha, I think that kind of is a good segue. You know, I hope I'm not bringing up when I bring up that, but it was just a memorable moment for me because, you know, you and I were talking in depth about some things. I know I was tied to some anger issues that I had with my father. I was tied to some unforgiveness that I had with my father. I was tied to that thing, and that thing bothered me for a minute. And the Lord had to sit me down and help me realize, as long as you're tied to that, you can never be freed from that. You can never be liberated from that. And here you are telling other folks to forgive, and you're out here preaching this, but you're still tied to this. And it's the thing behind the scenes that they have no idea about. But you're tied to this anger that you have. You need to learn how to forgive. So that was a challenging moment for me. And so that for me is an untying moment. And I'm not asking you to go back and reflect on that, but how did being freed from that help you to become the woman that you are today?
Honestly, I want to say turning my light on. That's the best way to put it. And because I stopped sitting in the background. So I started asking questions instead of being angry. So instead of just being angry, I was like, well, maybe I should just ask. And if I want to know something, because oddly enough, my favorite scriptures in the Bible is Matthew 7:1-7:7. And it can get you through anything in life. So I had to realize, well, if I'm so mad about something, I got to know why I'm mad. What really made me so upset? So to get free, you got to start from somewhere. So the first step was, all right, well, what am I even upset for? Next step, how can I get, free from this upsetness? Go to the source or whatever the situation is. So for me, being free, I had to first learn that it wasn't my fault. So when I realized I have nothing to do with why I'm even angry, this is other people angry. I'm just carrying their angriness with me, and it's making me heavy. So I had to let their stuff go to let my stuff go.
Wow.
I had to untie myself from their spirit, if that makes sense. So when you relieve yourself from someone else's spirit and realize that your life is your own life, then you can live better and you're more free. You can go and do what God sent you to do.
That's good. You know, when you labeled it as a spirit, it took me a minute to realize I wasn't just tied to the anger and the unforgiveness. It was a spirit that had me overwhelmed. There were moments that I just found myself, why are you thinking about this? Why is this dominating your thoughts? And God had to really help me to understand the spirituality of that situation. A lot of times, Sister Jackie, I don't think we recognize the spiritual connection of what's happening in our lives. And so for you, is there something that the Lord, and I don't mean for you to have to identify it particularly, but just the fact that he had to untie you from something in order to liberate you so that you could carry that word, be that word carried, be that woman of God that he would have for you to be? Was there an encounter for you in that regard?
Encounter. I don't want to say it's an encounter, or it was an encounter. I just feel like it was spiritual maturity.
Yeah.
And knowing that I'm not where I'm supposed to be. That's what happened for me. So knowing that, looking at different situations that do come about to where I do have to forgive, and understanding that forgiveness is not even for them, it's for me to move forward. So once I've, spiritually matured in those areas, I was able to move forward. I'm a background person, just like me personally. I mean, I own a hair salon. If you walked into the salon, you'd never know I was the owner. I don't have to be out front shining, the light shining on me. So from the background, it's like, I don't know. It's a lot. It's very deep for me, Bishop. So I don't know. Maybe this is something we would have to talk on a whole nother, maybe one-on-one almost.
I understand.
But forgiving people for things that I feel like maybe they wronged me in, it was hard. I've had to swallow it, as my husband's culture say, meaning I've had to digest it. I've had to get over it and move forward.
Yeah.
Just move forward. Life's too short to try to keep bitterness. I mean, bitterness is going to happen. Every day we have, is out and about, negativity will come. But how you handle it will be the overall victory of every negative situation.
Yeah. I'm in agreement with you. Kathy, Darkisha can't be with us for the entire broadcast or the time period. So I want to pick her brain before we let her go, and you can hang with us for a minute. But it reminds me, as we transitioned from Sunday to Monday, and Jesus comes in and he clears out the temple and everything that's not like God in God's house, which is supposed to be a house of prayer. He came in and literally turned over tables and got rid of everything that wasn't like God. And I see that, Starkisha, from a spiritual perspective. It's the same way with us. It's like our temples are the house of God. And everything that's in us that's not like God, Jesus comes to turn over some tables, turn over some thought patterns that we have, clean out some things in our heart and in our minds that don't glorify God, that mess up the whole purpose of the temple, the house of prayer, that we're supposed to be vessels like that. And so God came along again and swept us, swept through a lot of times our temples so that we could become those vessels that were meet for the master's use. And I perceive that with you, that I don't know, I've always perceived, in whether it was in our personal conversations or just in your comments alone, that God has always had his hands on your life for the purpose of preparing you for where he's taking you. You have the capability of walking into a room and commanding the attention. And I'm not talking about from a physical perspective, but your view of life, your who you are. And God has a way of using you for that. But it was the cleansing. It was the purifying. It is all of that that God does and had to do in order for us to become who we are. How does that relate for you, Jesus cleaning out the temple as well as cleaning out our temples?
That is a great question because like when I said, I lost my job. So in 2022, when I first joined the table, I literally kept praying and asking God to remove anything, anybody or whatever that did not need to be in my life. And when he started removing stuff from me, I was like, what is happening? Literally, I remember bawling in my mama's house. Like, Ma, why is this happening to me? What's happening to my life? And she was like, it's life starting. I was like, no. Like, I just was having a great job. I just became a licensed insurance agent. I am doing this. I'm doing that. But now everything is being taken from me. It was driving me crazy because I didn't understand. But I forgot. I was praying for God to remove what I didn't need in my life. I mean, friends was leaving and I was confused because I was like, wait a minute, my grandma just passed away. Though, where's my friends at? They supposed to be here for me. They're not here for me. Sorry. They're not here for me like they're supposed to be. But then I heard God say, but didn't you just ask me to remove me? And I was like, oh, yeah. So then I sat down for a little bit. I wasn't working for like maybe 6 months. I was doing what I wanted to do. Making money still, but it set, I was alone. Yeah. It set me in a spot alone. And I felt like there was nobody in my corner. I would call my mom to cry, but I didn't really want her to tell me what to do. I just wanted to be like, just to complain really, but it wasn't doing nothing. So when I stopped complaining and I realized that God said, hey, you said you wanted to do this. So I put you in Tennessee by yourself with no family, no friends, really no support. So you sit here by yourself because you keep relying on these people. But that's not what you need. I'm going to put you alone and I gave you me. So either you take me or you just sit by yourself.
Wow.
So that's what I've been going through this literally since I moved here in 2020. My life shifted. It shifted. And I asked for this and that's what I get. I got what I asked for. To be removed.
He knows how to do that. Kathy, do you think, and part of this class that's coming up that we'll talk a little bit about more later, the spiritual warfare. One of the struggles for me is that getting, I'll see the table, because these are some people who I believe I know dearly to a certain extent. Getting them to see that there is a spiritual connection to what you're going through. Because if you only see it through a natural lens, your murmuring and complaining will increase because all you're seeing is this natural situation going on that I'm out here in Tennessee by myself, ain't nobody around, and all you're complaining about is from the natural perspective of it. But what if there is behind it, not what if, the fact that there is a spiritual connection behind here that's working in high places, that what we preach and say all the time is going on, but we don't realize it, that God and the devil is up here in heavenly places creating situations that are being made manifest in the earth, but we just don't realize it because we don't take our time to even think sometimes that what if God is involved in this? What if the Spirit of God is orchestrating, moving stuff on the chess table just to get a reaction out of me or to see how I'm going to react to the situation? Kathy, how can we get that message across better, if you would, so that the table would understand, so that we would understand, okay, with all this murmuring and complaining I'm doing, when am I going to really pray, be patient, seek the face of God, and see that he might have a response for what I'm going through? I hope that makes sense.
We have to train ourselves to think spiritually all the time. You know, it can't be an event that causes us to think about God, the spirit realm. It can't be a circumstance that causes us to look at things from a spiritual eyesight. We have to understand that everybody is governed by a spirit 24/7. And when we look at some people's behavior, we have to think their behavior is just an outward display of what's in their hearts.
Yeah.
And so when things happen, it's like, okay, Lord, what is this about? I remember I was going through something and the Lord told me it was going to happen. And when it happened, I'm like, I rebuke this. Excuse me. I rebuke this in the name of Jesus. And the Lord is like, you can't rebuke me.
Wow.
My sheep know my voice. Yeah. And you knew it was me. But all of this comes out of relationship and communicating with him.
Yeah.
Once you build on your relationship and talking to him in the good and bad times, you'll always recognize his voice. And so when certain situations happen, we could take a step back and say, okay, Lord, what do you want me to get out of this? Or what do you want out of me? What do you want to put in me? Excuse me. It's like, okay, Lord, show me the exchange that you want to happen in this. What's this purpose? And then I don't have to get mad about it because it's uncomfortable.
Yeah.
We don't have to respond in an angry manner, in a sad manner, in whatever manner. It's like the Lord will show us, this is what I'm doing. If we pay close enough attention, the Holy Spirit will show us what's happening and we could just ride it out.
Amen. Amen. If we could just ride it out. Starkeisha, I know you got to go, dear, but before you go, I wanted to get your view on, as we view Holy Week, Monday, Jesus is clearing out the temple. Tuesday, he's speaking of what we commonly know as the abomination of desolation or the end times. They're asking him in Matthew 24 and 25, what will be the end and what will be the sign of his coming? But it's Wednesday that really intrigued me, because Wednesday, when Judas shows up, Wednesday is when they having the Feast of Unleavened Bread is drawing nigh. We call it the Passover. And the chief priests, they're thinking on ways to kill him, to kill Jesus. But they knew that the people favored him. But it is this time, Starkeisha, that Satan enters Judas's heart. Satan enters Judas's heart. And because he enters into his heart and Judas is there, yes, when he does that, he, being Judas, goes to the high priest and goes to them to help them find a way to betray Jesus. And when it comes down to it, at the table, Jesus lets it be made known. At the table, the Last Supper is being served, and Jesus wants it to be made known to Judas primarily. I know you. I know you. You're not doing something that I'm unaware of. I know who you are. I know the plot. I know the plan. But I'm going to invite you to the table anyhow. This is one of those things he's got to explain to me when I see him in glory. How you knew Judas is who he is, but you yet invited him to the table. Have you ever had to encounter that where there were some Judases in your life and you had to recognize who your Judas was, but you were strong enough to not let them overwhelm you, change you, but you still could be in their presence? Before you get out of here, I got to get you to answer that tough one.
Yes. Yes. So I don't even know when it changed. I don't know how I was able to be in. So my girl's father, my ex-husband, it was a point in time where we couldn't be in the same room without each other trying to want, in better, lack of better words, kill each other. So I had to pray about that. I had to pray to be able to be in his presence and not feel anger and hate and bitter and all of that. So that was all God. I had to ask God to forgive, to help me forgive him for all the things that I know that he did to me and that he's going to continue to do to me and to the kids, and forgive him and to be there without allowing my flesh to react. So I had to pray to allow my flesh to be calm. So I had to learn to do that. And that took me a long time because anyone that knows me, I'm real short. So even with my shortness comes a short temper sometimes. So I had to learn that. Jackie, I didn't ask you that. So I have a short temper and short patience. So if it's not happening fast enough for me, literally, it's like I'm like that, like a toddler. I have a tantrum, like I was explaining the other day. So I had to learn how to not have tantrums. And that takes some time. So I'm going to tell every person that's on here before I have to go clock into work, because I'm going to jump on. To allow yourself to not be like a Judas, the only thing that you can do is to pause in that moment. So when it's coming to you, you need to pause in that moment. So it happens to me every day at work. These people drive me insane at work. And I have to pause before I respond because they're asking me questions as I don't know my job. And I pause before I respond. God, help me get through this moment. So I don't allow my flesh to respond and I allow you to respond.
Amen. Amen. That's beautiful. Thank you so much.
I know you have... in the messages.
Thank you for being with us on this morning. May the Lord bless your day and bless your life continually. Thank you so much for being a part of the table.
You're welcome.
Amen. Bye, guys. Amen. Amen. Bless you. Sister Jackie, thank you so much. You want to talk about Judas, or you had to know you? My concern is that Kathy as well, and Table, when I say know your Judas, I don't mean know their name. I'm not saying to us, and I don't think that the Lord was concerned about Judas's his name. We don't take time out to get to know the people that are in our lives that are, quote unquote, operating in the role of a Judas. So the suggestion of get to know your Judas is not to know them intellectually, nor know their name. You got to know their purpose. This is much deeper than we would ever contemplate in our minds. But Jesus let him hang around long enough so that Judas would recognize, I know your purpose. I know what you've come to do. I know your plot. I know your plan. You're not fooling me. And I think if we're not careful, we let our anger, our disappointment, our frustration overwhelms us, and it blinds us to the very thing that God wants us to know is, there he is, or there she is. I don't need you to run them away from the table. I need you to let them sit right there. Now show me your level of maturity that you can sit across the table from them, let them know you know what they're doing, but it's not moving you. That's a spiritual thing that many of us are not ready for because of our own carnal way of viewing it. But your thoughts, I see you sitting there looking like that, Sister Jackie. I hope we didn't. But your thoughts before we
allow you. Me or Sister Cat?
You, Jackie. I need you.
Okay. Transparent moment, Bishop.
Amen.
in all actuality, situations that have happened between my husband and myself. I've called him Judas. because sometimes I'll see things ahead of seeing things. And when I see it, I call it out. And I've called out some things, you know, and of course, unfortunately, it come to pass. But I'm still sitting. I'm still there.
Yeah.
So that's not the only situation, but that's just one that really have stuck out for me. It's been a trying time. It will test your faith.
Yeah.
It'll test your level of maturity spiritually. And again, I've looked at it as, okay, God, what is it that I'm supposed to learn? What is it that I need to change? You know, because of course, as we all know as Christians, sometimes God allows things to happen to get your attention.
Yeah.
So that's why I've looked at it in that perspective of saying, okay, I can't bail out, because trust me, I've been married before. And when things did not go right, I packed up everything and my son and we left. But again, maturity. Yeah. So that's, for me, a good transparent moment to say that that lines up with having, I felt, a Judas in my life.
Yeah, these are Morning Manna Ministry moments when people are transparent enough to share with the table stuff that you, Jackie, don't even realize at the table are some individuals who had to face the same thing that you faced. And in the midst of you sharing, it liberates them.
Yes. And so
what if God is in all of it, to the extent that, Jackie, I'm going to let you go through some things. Jesus, I'm going to let you go through some things so your Judas will offend, will hurt, will be the cause of a level of pain for you. But at the same time, Jesus, I'm going to save the world through your pain. At the same time, Jackie, I'm going to touch some hearts at the table through your pain. What if God, who is omniscient, who is sovereign, he can do what he wants to do. What if he wants to use you and move you on the table in order to free somebody else? That's on the table. All I'm asking, I think, is that we heighten our awareness to the fact that it's not always about us. And if we take it personal, we will never experience the liberation that comes along with realizing that maybe God is in this. Maybe, as with Job, God's trying to save Job's friends through Job's pain. Maybe he's trying to save Joseph's brothers through Joseph being in a pit. We don't like that part, Kathy. We don't like that part. Save them some other kind of way. Do something up, but don't take me through the pain. It's a part of the cup that Jesus had to say, nevertheless, not my will, but your will.
One other thing, Bishop, not to cut you off, but in reference to going through, I've been diagnosed with cancer. And out of all my siblings, I was the only one. So I'm like, okay, God, why me? Why me being the baby of our family? So had the surgery, removed the cancer, and where it was located, I shouldn't be here.
Wow.
So I know that it was for a reason. So when I went through it, and I'm like, okay, all the African doctors we know, but one particular doctor brought us to his house. He broke down everything in layman's terms for me to understand why I needed to do chemo. I didn't want to do it because I'm like, that's poison, you know. So he explained it's a good poison, but yet it is a bad poison. So fine, moved on from that. And at that time, my girls, they're my, you know, younger, they were in my face just even the more, just more. So I'm like, my God. I said, okay, so because of these two little ones right here, I'm going to do this chemo. So I was expected to do 6 rounds of chemo. Went in, So then the lady was saying, my oncologist was saying how my body agreed, you know, was whatever, you know, responding to the chemo. So she knocked it down from 6 to 5. Well, next thing I know, I only had to do 4 rounds of chemo to the point where I was done. So I thank God for that. But I still worked in my salon. I had 2 ladies that quit the month before I got sick. So I was in my salon by myself. And from there, it's like, okay, God, I'm in here by myself. I feel horrible. I was losing weight like it was nobody's business, which I didn't mind the weight loss, but not through sickness. So from there, okay, I'm still doing customers. I'm still doing customers. So oddly enough, after I kind of get over my milestone of sickness, I would go get infused for about 4 or 5 hours, and I would leave with a port still infusing me for another 24 hours. And I would work with the port still in me, but it would be under my little vest or whatever. So shortly thereafter, like I said, after everything was done, I had one, she's now retired military sergeant major. She told me that she was diagnosed with cancer.
Wow.
And I'm like, no. Well, hers was breast cancer. And of course, that's very aggressive. So long story short, she started asking me questions about cancer. What did I feel? What did they do? What chemo was like? How did you feel after the chemo? All of these things. So I shared everything I knew. So from there, she said, you know, you didn't have cancer. I said, what do you mean? She said, because you made it look too easy. I said, her name was Sonia. I said, Sonia, that wasn't me. That was nobody.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Nobody but God. Because as I went back to get my port removed, where they infused me, the lady, the nurse or whatever she was putting my information in the computer. And from there, she said, how did you know that you had cancer? I said, well, I said I was in pain. You know, the pain was like very unbearable and I was losing weight, whatever. So from there, she said, she stopped typing. She said, ma'am, she said, I don't know what type of woman or person you are. She said, but the type of cancer you had, you wasn't supposed to know until it was too late. I said, well, I said, they said it was stage 2. She said, yeah. She said, you wasn't supposed to know it's stage 2. Again, I wanted to shout in this small cubicle that we were in, but it wasn't enough space, trust me. But other than that, I know God is working on me and through me. I know these things because of different experiences and quote unquote testimonies that I have to share with people. And as much as I know, it was 2 other ladies that came behind her with the same diagnosis.
Hallelujah.
Same questions. And I'm like, I said, I get it, God. I get it. Hallelujah. I cannot keep it to myself.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
So
yes,
that cancer was my Judas in that situation.
I understand.
Yes, sir.
You know, all of these things that, Kathy, that we face. First of all, Jackie, I want to appreciate you for that transparent moment, that trust me. You know, my daughter is right where you are. Where you were, she is right now. Right where you were, she is right now. And I'm hoping that she's listening. And if not, I'm praying that this will get to her. Because this is how liberation happens when others are willing to share their hearts, if you would. And this is one of the things I thank the table for. So first of all, I want to thank you so much for being with us on this morning and taking our time to share that, because I know that it blessed somebody, and we appreciate you.
Amen. Thank you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. Certainly. Amen. Thanks again for coming and being with us.
You're welcome. Thank you.
We'll see you again. Amen. What a testimony, Kathy. What an encounter, what an experience. And you know, it takes me, and I really want to kind of close this broadcast sharing with you on our Judas and recognizing it not from a physical perspective. What I love about Jesus, the many things I love about the Master in particular is how he handled Judas. I just love, I got to get there. I got to get where he was in handling people who you know, not just people who you know, but it's the spirit of betrayal. It's not the person, but it's the spirit that motivates the person. And I need y'all to see this, Kathy. The scripture says, then entered. Why is Luke writing this? He says, then entered Satan into Judas, which tells us it's not really Judas. He must take accountability for what he did. The reality of it is, it's more than just Judas. It's Satan entering into Judas, being of the number of the 12. He's a part of Jesus's 12, but Satan enters into him. Kathy, do you think most of us take out time to realize that while they did it, it wasn't just them who did it, but it's a spirit that they're operating in? This is why this telling y'all, this class, it opens up my mind. Dr. Evans does a marvelous job of opening up my mind to understanding stuff I should have understood years ago. But the reality of it is, yeah, Satan is entered into, just like he entered into Peter and Jesus had to say, get behind me, Satan. He enters into Judas. He entered into James and John, and Jesus had to ask them what manner of spirit. So all of these people who were close to Jesus, Kathy, they were close to Jesus, but the devil still got in them. What can we learn from that? That every one of us is going to have a Judas, and it's the Satan that's in the Judas that we must also recognize. Yes, Judas is going to have to pay. Yes, he is the son of perdition. Yes, we already know that, but Jesus treats him, Kathy, like, I know who you are. I know that spirit you're operating in, and I'm not going to let it cause you to keep me from recognizing who you are. Your thoughts on this?
Bishop, what we have to do is be so tight with God that we can recognize Judas.
Yeah.
See, if I'm so familiar with God, then I am faster at recognizing Judas. Judas is not just a person or coming through a person. I'm glad you said that, but that Judas is a spirit of death, a spirit of rejection. Everything that comes with death, it's that spirit of Judas also. And when I think about Judas, one of the first things I always think, I was like, boy, I'm so glad it wasn't my life assignment.
Yeah.
That Jesus up to be crucified.
Yeah.
Woo! I'm so glad that wasn't my life assignment. We know that Jesus had to be crucified. Boy, I wouldn't want to be the person.
Whoa to him. Yes.
And so, like I said, when we are tight enough with the Holy Spirit, he causes us to be able to recognize Judas. Yeah. And we can't take sin personal. It's a spiritual thing. We can't take sin personal. That's why we get all discombobulated and frustrated and uptight, and which could lead us into gossip with some other people about this person and lead us into murmuring and complaining. It has nothing to do with all of that.
Yeah.
It's a spiritual thing.
Yeah.
And then when your Judas comes, what God is looking at is, okay, I'm gonna see how you handle this. Okay. Because the world needs to see us respond like Jesus.
What you say? Be careful now. Be careful now.
It is so not about your feelings. I was talking to somebody the other day. I said, you know what? Maybe I'm not that close with Jesus, because he never asked me how I felt about acting like him.
Yeah.
It's not a feeling. It's obedience. God, he's not looking us to feel like responding like him. Uh-uh. He said, just be obedient. Respond like me. And so, just like with my sister Jackie, her response to the cancer was such a spiritual thing, because she taught people without knowing how you could respond when you have Jesus. And so when we respond, when we're in a life circumstances, when the Judases come, because they will, we have to think, how can I respond in such a way that's going to glorify God, not glorify Kathy, not make me feel good, not make me feel whatever.
Yeah.
How can my response to the Judas spirit, the spirit that came into Judas, how can I respond where God will get glory?
Hallelujah. I hope y'all listening. You know, I hope we're listening this morning. I really do. Bishop Oscar Benton, bless you, sir. I appreciate you being with us on this morning, man. I got to honor you, and I appreciate you for being with us and the work that the Lord has you doing. Kathy, I want us to take a look at this morning manna. Please take a moment, because this is designed, I believe, to help the believer in response to your Judases. Recognize that Luke puts this in here for a purpose and a reason. He says, be aware of the fact that even though Judas is a part of the 12, even though that Peter was a part of the 12, even though that James and John, the sons of thunder, were part of the 12, all of them had a moment when Satan entered into them and was leading them to say, remember what they said. Remember James and John, sons of thunder, say, shall we call down fire upon them and consume them? They wanted to kill the Samaritans. Peter wanted to stop Jesus from going to his purpose. Here Judas is being used to actually betray Jesus. Notice what he says, Kathy. Jesus, knowing this, says, but behold, the hand of him that betrayeth me is with me on the table. I love this about Jesus. He says, behold, I'm not stupid. Not blind. They think you stupid, and they think you blind because you haven't called them out yet. It wasn't the season to call him out. It wasn't the time to call him out. If you call him out too soon, he won't betray you. And if he doesn't get the chance to betray you, Kat never gets saved. Kevin never gets saved. None of us ever get saved. He can't call his Judas out too soon. Some of y'all calling your Judas out too soon. Some of y'all are letting it be made known too soon that you know who they are. You got to be, as you said, Kathy, you have to walk with God so closely, he will let you know now is the time to let it be made known that I know who you are. And this pushes Judas, Kathy, this pushes Judas to go sell him. In this moment, Judas knows Jesus knows. He didn't know until this moment. Where did he find out? At the table. And some of us won't bring him to the table. Judas, Jesus is wise. I want you to know, but I'm going to wait till we get into an intimate setting. This is an intimate setting when all of the other brothers are there. Jesus led him into an intimate setting, and Judas thinks he thinks he's getting over on Jesus like Jesus don't know. They think they're getting over on you like you don't know. They don't know. You don't need to let everybody know. You don't need to let every spirit know. This is spiritual. Jesus knows that Satan has entered. He says, behold, though, I'm not going to let you get away without having some level of culpability in this. Behold, the hand of him that betrayed me is at the table. And truly the Son of Man goeth. In other words, I got to do what I'm ordained to do. I got to go in the route that the Father has chosen for me. But he says, woe to that man whom he betrayeth. In other words, Judas, you're not going to get away with it. Don't fool yourself. Even though Satan got in you to do it, you're going to still be held accountable for what you've done. Kathy, I think it's important for us, Morning Manna, I think it's important for us to know, not intellectually, not just know their name, but you got to recognize the job of your Judas. We're going with these last two things. You got to recognize the job of your Judas, and you got to recognize the journey of your Judas. Recognize the job of Judas, Kathy, is to betray him. He was born to betray Jesus. He was born to be God. The Father knew that he was going to betray him, use that betrayal as a means of Jesus actually being discovered. Because at this point, Kathy, the Romans don't even know who Jesus is. They don't know what he looks like. They have no idea until Judas kisses him. Judas had to kiss him because he went and got the Pharisees, Sadducees, brought them all to him. And Judas said, the one that I kiss, that's the one who he is. In other words, sometimes your Judases have to be close to you. They have to be close to you. This is not in every case, but it is in the case of your Judases. The job of your Judas is to betray you. And when they betray you, don't you think it's over? Don't you think that just because you got betrayed, because they mistreated you, did what they did, that it ain't over yet. All Judas was, Kathy, was the fuel that the Father used to exalt the Son. He used the betrayal of Judas to push Jesus to his destiny. The journey that Judas had to take had to come through the table, Kathy. He's got some of your Judases. They got to sit with you. And you got to know they're sitting with you. And you got to eat with them while looking at them in the eye and letting them know. Not looking at them cross-eyed like you mad and mean and rolling your neck. Not that one. with the kind of affection that says, I know who you are. And I know what you did. But let me let you know in this moment, even with all you did, you ain't moving me. You're not changing me. I know my destiny. And every plot that you did, everything you said, can't stop what God has for my destiny. That's a mature response to your Judas. Which are you? Are you going to sit there and roll your neck and get mad and cuss him out? You're letting him know you got to me. You're letting him know you got to me, Judas. And Jesus wasn't having that. Your thoughts, Kathy?
Although Judas didn't know the outcome of his behavior,
yeah,
there was promise, there was victory in the betrayal. And so we have to see what God is doing on the other side of the betrayal. I've been in situations where somebody at the job was trying to get me in trouble and all this stuff. And the Lord told me, he said, be still and know that I'm God. He said, I don't want you to defend yourself. And I'm like, but Lord, they talking about me, rah, rah, rah. He said, well, they talked about me too. But he didn't allow me to expose the Judas until it was time. And then the Holy Spirit told me, he said, okay, now you could say something about it. And this is who I want you to say it to. So he released me to speak about what was happening, but I would speak. He had me to go speak to the person who was directly under a general. He didn't tell me to go talk to my friends and murmur and complain. He told me exactly how to handle it. And then also another point, Bishop, although Jesus knew that Judas was going to set him up, he never stopped his ministry.
Stop it. Stop it. Mm.
He never stopped his ministry. He never stopped sowing into Judas. He didn't let Judas's plans divert him. He didn't let the thought of what Judas was going to do change his purpose. He kept teaching. He kept doing ministry. He kept loving. He kept teaching. He kept, you know what? We got to stop allowing stuff to stop us from what God has called us to do.
Hallelujah.
Judas was not able to stop Jesus's journey.
Hallelujah.
Judas was there with him on the journey.
Hallelujah.
He made the plans while on the journey with Jesus.
Yeah.
But Jesus never stopped.
Lord, have mercy. This is the middle of the week, y'all. Jesus is en route to his destiny. This is the middle of the week, y'all. And he runs into Judas. Kathy, he never stopped. I need y'all to eat what she just said. Eat it all up. He never stopped being kind to Judas because he recognized the spirit that Judas was operating in.
Yes.
You're giving your hand away too soon. When you start rolling that neck and saying, I'm going to give you a piece of my mind and tell you how I feel, you're getting in the way of the plan of God. How about you hold your peace, let the Lord fight your battle? How about you hold your peace, let them think that you don't know? When they think you don't know, you got them right where you want them. Let them think you don't know. Let them think that I'm up here in her house, at her table, and she don't even that I'm talking about it. Let them think that. Let them think what they want to think. God has told you to be quiet and don't change.
Yes.
Hold on, but you about to take it personal now because your flesh ain't dead. The anger part of you still wants to tell them a piece of your mind. That's the flesh part that has to die. That's the anger part. You don't even recognize the word. This is so spiritual that God is saying, I need you to die. Hold your mouth. Close your mouth. I need you to die. I need you to be quiet right now. If you respond, you're gonna respond too soon.
Yes.
Not only, Kathy, does Jesus feed him amongst his brothers, but he also washes this boy's feet. He washes Judas's feet. They both occurring at the same time. This is a level of spirituality, that spiritual warfare that most of the church is not ready for. We're not ready for this level of spiritual warfare because all we know how to do is shout. All we know how to do is go in the sanctuary and shout it out. Just shout it out so I can feel good. Come on, get your dance on, get your praise on so you can feel good. But as soon as God says, here comes your Judas, there you go tripping. All you have is an emotional shout. It's got to be more to this walk with God than an emotional shout. How about we learn how to deal with our Judas? Know his job, know her job. Her job is to betray you. It's your fault that you didn't recognize, you didn't do your background check. It's your fault that you don't realize she's here to betray you. She's here to sell you out. And if you don't get sold out, if you don't, then your purpose can't be fulfilled. Jesus has to be betrayed. But he says, woe to the one to whom it is that betrays me. But he has to be betrayed. And the Father takes advantage of Satan's move. I'm going to say this and we're done, Kathy. Because it's Satan who enters into Judas. And Satan says, check, because he think he got him. He says, check, because he think he got him. But the Father ain't playing checkers. He's playing chess. The Father says, oh, so you think you got me because you sent Judas to betray me. But when Jesus doesn't fall for the trap, the Father says, checkmate with the resurrection. Checkmate with the resurrection. What you all keep doing is trying to just get checked. I don't want check. I want, the devil has been checkmated. He's been checkmated. And you and I can't keep losing battles to a fella that's been checkmated. He's already been defeated. He can only influence you. He can only send more little Judases to try to get you out of control. Don't fall for the trap of the devil. Take the class. It's coming up. Kathy, yours. We got to go. Hallelujah.
Okay, I have two quick points. Some of us, we get frustrated, and that's when we get into gossip and going to talk to other people on the job or other people in the family, because we're trying to find out what somebody is saying or doing or trying to do to us, what they say. Or we come up with these little conversations so we could try to see what somebody's plotting or planning against you. Let me share something with you. The Holy Spirit is in every behind closed door conversation about you.
Come on.
Holy Spirit is there. You don't have to be there. You don't have to ask anybody. The Holy Spirit will reveal to you how he wants you to respond. I don't care what they say. I don't care what they say. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And what I need to know, according to St. John 14:26, the Holy Spirit is going to teach me anyway. And the second thing is, Jesus's behavior was always about his destiny.
Come on.
Our behavior, our responses, they have to be about our destinies in the kingdom.
Ma'am, have to be. Have to be. And if they're not, you're going to miss the move that God has for you. Yeah. So we've been celebrating this week. We've got one more day on Friday to celebrate. And as we've been going through Holy Week, it is designed with you in mind. It is designed, Morning Manna, with you in mind. I got to thank Starkeisha again. Got to thank Sister Jackie again for both coming on and really being a blessing. Listen, 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 please, Morning Manna, because there's a segment at this table that's not playing. You're quite serious about your salvation, and you're quite serious about your relationship with God. And because you're quite serious about your salvation and you're quite serious about your relationship with God, you don't fit the norm. You don't fit the norm of Christianity of the day because you're quite serious about your walk with God. And so consequently, you are apt to have some Judases come against you. It's destined. You are destined to have some Judases come against you. And so this class, Kathy, is designed to help the table. I'm giving y'all far enough advance notice so you can put it on your calendar. You can register for it. This class, the whole purpose for me in class is to take you from a carnal perspective, to take you from a worldly perspective of how you view things. Because you're in this body, you're going to see things from the natural, but you don't have to leave it there. You got to graduate to the level of understanding that the weapons of my warfare truly are not carnal, and that I know I'm not wrestling. Jesus knew I'm not wrestling against flesh and blood. He knew when he was dealing with Peter that Satan was in him. He knew that he was dealing with Judas that Satan was in him. He knew that when he had to rebuke James and John, the sons of thunder, that Satan was in. He knew. You got to get to the level of spiritual awareness where you start recognizing this ain't nothing. The devil for real. And if you know it's the devil for real, why are you responding just in the flesh? Why is your response only, I'm giving you a piece of my mind? Why haven't you interceded in prayer? Why hasn't it driven you into a deeper spiritual place? If you truly recognize that this is of the devil. And so again, here is the class. Here is the information. If you're a first time viewer of the broadcast, I want to encourage you to register for this class. I promise you, it's going to bless your life. It's one of the money back guarantees, not because of the teacher, but because of the information that if you digest it and you allow it, it will move you to another place in him. And well, it's our Wednesday time that we come together, and you all know that here is the book I want you to get. And those of you who want to get the book, you don't have to have the book for the class, but as in any other thing, when it comes to this level of ITS, Institute of Theological Studies, that, you know, I like to use books, and I like for you to put it in your hands so that you can, it's like when you go to school and you get a book, history book, you get a book that's going to help you to develop. And so you want it for more information, amen, I want you to request it. And I know that the Lord bless you. Amen. I want you all to be a blessing on today. There's some things I certainly want to do for this table, some people who I want to bless at this table. And as you bless the table, you're going to give us an opportunity to be. I want to bless the Brockingtons. I want to bless the Joys. I want to bless the Jacksons. I want to be a blessing to this table. And during our time celebration, they have ministered for you, to you for a whole year. Some of y'all, they have ministered to you for a whole year. And I want to be a blessing to those who make up this table, even the Kathys of this world. I want to be a blessing. And I want the table to be a blessing. So I want you to join me in this morning and creating a purse, if you would, that's going to allow the table to distribute to those who have been instrumental in your development, instrumental in the table becoming who it is. And so those of you who say that, I got to. Your whatever it is you give, whatever gift you sow. I love the fact that it's never too small and it's never too great. But it's your time to say to those who've been a blessing to you at the table as we celebrate. You can give all week long, really. The reality of it is it's going to be a blessing to those who make up this table. So do that. Consider that. And I believe that the Lord will bless your life. Again, if you're a first-time viewer of the broadcast, you know that we don't come on here every time that we're on here and ask you for this or that. We save Wednesdays as an opportunity for us to be the time when we present our gifts unto the Father. And so, Kathy, I'm grateful. But your thoughts before we get out of here on this morning?
Don't respond in kind. Don't respond in the flesh. Remember that there will always be a Judas that wants to keep you from your destiny.
Yeah. There's always a Judas to keep you from your destiny. And you know what? As hard as Judas tried, Kathy, and as hard as Satan tried, he couldn't stop Jesus. Matter of fact, the scripture says in 1 Corinthians that had they known, they would have never crucified the Lord of glory. I want you to leave with that thought in mind, because what Paul understood was if the devil really understood by killing Jesus, we get more little Jesuses, he'd have left Jesus alone. It would have been better for him to leave him alone and let him live and die of natural causes. But the mere fact that you crucified him according to the way he was prophetically declared, you helped the Father fulfill the prophecies concerning Jesus. You would have been better. I'm telling y'all, some of them, some of your Judases, they should have left you alone. The mere fact that they decided to mount against you, I guarantee you, the mere fact that they mounted against you, the Father will turn that into an exaltation of you. If I be lifted up from the earth because you tried to keep me on the earth, if I be, I'll draw all men. The Father, the enemy can't stop you from your destiny. Keep your head up. Keep your head up. Kathy, ma'am, it's always good. You didn't even talk about Diosha. I got to give you an applause. You didn't even talk about your son.
Is my boy, that's my dude. I love Diosha. I love his heart. I love his spirit. I love his fire, man. I love that dude. Oh, gosh. I love some Diosha.
He's special. Hallelujah. He's special. Amen. We appreciate you on this morning, woman of God, and we're so grateful. I want you to pray for us before we get out of here and begin the rest of our holy week. Again, thanks to our guests that were with us. And then I guess thanks to the family member from the table who were with us on this morning. Got an abundance. We got some more coming on Friday that's already signed and willing to be with us. I think Lady Rhonda Rollins is going to be with us. Yarbroughs are going to be with us. Joy is going to be with us. There's a bunch of people that's going to pop in and share with us. And so Friday is going to be a great broadcast. We're looking for you all to be back here with us. Kathy, you look lovely on today as well. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
We are in your hands, ma'am.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much.
Yes, Lord.
It's this privilege and honor to sup with you, to be taught, to be to be imparted.
Ooh.
You, oh God.
Hallelujah.
Father, from what we've heard, we ask that you will produce a harvest.
Yes.
A harvest that will bring you glory, oh God. Walk with us as we mature with you.
Yes. Continue,
teach us, Holy Spirit.
Just teach us.
Teach us how to respond that will glorify you. Teach us how to live in such a way that will glorify you. Give us spiritual discernment to recognize the Judases and the ability to respond like you.
Yes, Father.
Oh God, I thank you for this table. It's touched people across the globe. Bless this global ministry, oh God.
Hallelujah.
It's this global ministry, oh God. You said in Isaiah 55:11 that your word will go forth and it will not return unto you void, but it will accomplish what you sent it to do and prosper in that thing.
Yes.
So, God, we thank you that thank the you. Word from this table is going forth.
Yes,
Holy, God. Cause it to produce what you've purposed for it to produce. Bless the table, the members at the table, oh God, those who have taken their time out to come and sit.
Yes.
Oh God.
Thank you, Lord.
Spiritual health and nutrition to them. Bless their lives. Keep them covered. Holy Spirit, hover over their lives.
Over.
Mm. The name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen and amen. Thank you, woman of God. Thank you so much. Amen. You know, the door remains open for you. Anytime you want to come sit at the table, just let us know. You've got your seat with your name on it. And we're grateful to God for us. So, Morning Manna, have a super fantastic, marvelous Wednesday. May the Lord bless you and keep you until our Friday morning broadcast. The Lord says the same. But until then, we love you. There's nothing you can do about that. But it's always in our party. Remember, whatever you do, stay in his word, because his word is alive. God bless you.